Again, just a quick word about who we are. We're the Blockchain Association of AI, and we met with Sandra at the beginning of the year. And the event tonight is actually an event we've been wanting to organize for a while now, because usually we bring banks, we bring, let's say, institutional, big organizations that are interested in this new buzzword, etc. But for a while, we wanted an event that would be more focused on actually where is the movement coming from, where is the technology coming from, and what are the underlying principles of the technology. So here we have Sandra and Laurent. They both co-founded in, I think, in 2013 or 14, Ethereum Madrid. 15. The goal was to spread knowledge about blockchain technology, Ethereum, and most recently they founded Crypto-Economic Hub, where the goal is to do research about crypto-economics, which is the study of incentives on a blockchain system. So tonight they're gonna present you crypto-anarchism and cypherpunk. So what's the ideology and the philosophy behind the whole movement? That's it.
All right, thank you all very much for coming, and thank you, Theo, for inviting us today. Today is a very important day for us at Crypto-Economics Hub that Sandra and I decided to found very recently, like officially. We've been in the field for the past a little bit more than 2 years now, and it was at the time where the only ICO you could talk about was Ethereum. So you can imagine how the field was back in those days. And everything was new, right? So a lot of promises, a lot of ideas and fundamentals that you might want to understand the way you wanted, but nothing was really like taking shape or a particular form. And since then, a lot of things have happened, as you are aware, I suppose. And we think it's time to come back to the fundamental layer of blockchain technologies and also the movement to realize where does all this come from. And you can only do that if you understand and share the vision that is behind all this. And the vision of this movement is really about providing the population of this planet with tools, right, and ways to organize in a way that goes beyond the scope of what governments can do, banks can do, geographical borders can represent, and go all beyond that. But for that, we need tools that we can't do as closed societies. It has to be tools that goes that are established on a global scale. And if you start looking at how to do this, you realize that cryptoeconomics is really the fundamental layer of all blockchain technologies and projects that lives on top of any blockchain. And why is that? Well, it's because cryptoeconomics is about designing incentives, what we call mechanisms in general. And those incentives are the ways that we can foster collaboration and cooperation between people, between participants in those systems, and therefore go beyond the scope of what societies by themselves as a closed system can do. And so the trick is really to design those incentives in a certain way, right? But let's not forget the objective, because you can very easily go like deeper and deeper into the technicalities of all this, which is absolutely fine and necessary. But if we start forgetting about the vision of and where we want to go with all that, then you might start seeing, say, deviations or things that shouldn't have happened, or that maybe are not the best things or the best allocation of resources and time and money in all this, right? And so for us, this session that Sandra is going to present us is really a coming back to the vision that is responsible, if you will, of what is happening in the space, in the blockchain space, for the last, for the last decade, really. And so we're really happy to be able to do this with you tonight. And with that, I leave you, Sandra, with your talk.
Okay, so again, welcome everybody to this talk about cypherpunk and crypto-anarchism. Who here heard about one of the two before? Okay, you have to, because otherwise I can't see if you do like this. And who here has an idea what it is? Okay, good. So maybe, hopefully, I can give you a little bit idea today what it is actually about. The goal of this talk is not to convince anybody of anything. The only goal I have is to make you think and reflect on our world. Because this is actually the idea behind these two movements. So first of all, that is a little bit the current state. And this chart, I had no time to update it. It's actually from 2017. So I don't know really where it is right now, but blockchain is all over the place, no? So you can't enter a room, you can't enter. I was, for example, in the plane yesterday, and what was the conversation next to me about? Bitcoin, of course. So it's everywhere. And this is the search results. So we don't know who's behind these searching activities. But we also know that especially companies now want desperately to implement blockchain. Yeah? And this represents a little bit the situation we have sometimes, because blockchain is all about decentralization. And in the companies, we might not have this decentralized structure. So then we come to a kind of a dilemma, which you see in this comic. But where is this actually coming from? Is this a technology? I mean, most of the people, they want to learn now how to write smart contracts. And I ask myself, why do all these people want to learn how to write smart contracts? So most of the people say it's a new technology. Yeah, and we had new technologies before. And actually, we had the same movements before. So if you look back in the past, it all started in the 60s. In the 60s, we had a hacker movement all around personal computers, because for the first time, some people realized with this technology, we can actually come together and create something new. So they met in garage and all this and started to coding. Then, some years later, we had actually the internet, the World Wide Web, which is representing a global hyperlinked information system. So, for the first time, we were able to spread information globally, everywhere. And again, it was not the technology, it was actually the idea behind that moved this development of technology. And actually, 10 years back, which is also important to realize, it's 10 years back, someone we still don't know who, and I guess we will never know, because that would be really stupid to say it. So someone developed a peer-to-peer cash system. So for the first time, we had actually a system which allows us to distribute value without intermediaries, without banks. And what do all these movements actually have in common? Is it the technology? No, it's actually the thinking behind. And the thinking behind is that technology can shape humanity. So it's not about just developing, just doing. I mean, I could ask you now, why are you interested in blockchain? Is it because you want to be up to date? Is it because in your company it's now the topic? Or is it actually because you want to do something in this world? Because this is the main reason of all these revolutions. And at the moment, we are in the last revolution. So we are in this peer-to-peer cash system revolution. What happened to the first two ones is the ideas were there, the movement started, and then something interesting always happened. Capital was flowing into this movement. And when capital was flowing in, suddenly the ideas changed. Suddenly, open systems became close. Suddenly, collaboration was not the main goal anymore. And in Bitcoin, in the revolution behind Bitcoin and blockchain, we are now exactly at the same moment. So what we see now is capital flowing in a huge amount. And the question now is a little bit what Laurent also said, what will we do the same again? So will we change because of the capital? Will we forget about the ideas? Something you said, it's surprising that so few people are here. And it's surprising to me that that nearly no one really wants to know where it's coming from. Yeah. So it's all about, I want to know how to write a smart contract, but why? Do you ever ask yourself why I want to know this? No? So that is actually the moment where we are right now. We are in this last revolution, and we are exactly now in this moment of giving it a direction. Do we have the same situation as before, or do we actually make a change with this technology? Okay, so what is the general idea? The general idea behind crypto-anarchism and cypherpunks is that we live in a world about mass civilians, and it's important to know that for you, this is now normality. So we are totally adapt to a situation where we are not surprised, not even shocked by anything anymore. The movement around crypto-anarchism started in the 90s, where the situation was still really different. But they were able to foresee exactly what is happening now. And they knew that this is going to happen, that we have, through the internet, we have the possibility to control everything, everywhere, and any moment. And I mean, you all hear about Facebook, it's obvious. I'm quite surprised how easy it is to calm people, because I ask myself, is Mark Zuckerberg really the problem here? Is he responsible for all the civilians? And what is going to happen in 3 months? Will we still talk about this? Will we leave Facebook? Will we change anything? So think about the information you get and why you get this information. Then the problem of mass civilians is it produces fear. We live here in a world, we live in the Occidental world, which is a special world, because we think we are free. I'm not so sure if we're really free, but in some countries it's quite obvious that they are not free. And this leads to censorship through fear. So people are not talking about certain things anymore. I did a lot of research about crypto-anarchism and cypherpunk, and I had problems sometimes. Do I really want to search for this? Do I really make people know that I search for certain things? And this fear has an impact on my behavior and has an impact on what I'm saying. Because we are already totally fine with digital civilians, but also be aware, more and more we get physical. In the physical world, we also get more and more civilians. So this fear leads to a censorship. Yeah? So people are not expressing their ideas and their criticism anymore. You all know Edward Snowden, and he said it quite straight to the point in this comment. He said, like, privacy is the fountainhead head of all other rights. Freedom of speech doesn't have a lot of meaning if you can't have a quiet space, a space within yourself, within your mind, within the community of your friends, within your home, to decide what it is you actually want to say. So this is something we don't have, and we will even have less in the future if everything goes how it is going right now. And the question is, how will the world look like if we don't have this space anymore? And at the moment, we live in a world which is called the post-truth world. So this means what we see as information is the truth which is created. Truth can be created and is actually paid, because we gain our information through a digital resource, which we have seen before, is centralized and is controlled. And what this means, I want to show you in a video, which I hope... Okay, this video, you have to pay attention, okay? Because it's you think it is something, but then it's actually something else. Okay, let's see.
Terror struck in the heart of the city as thousands of people were seen running away from the downtown plaza area after someone called in a chemical weapons threat. Authorities are considering encryption.
No.
An earthquake prompted this incredible footage of thousands of frightened people evacuating in the middle of downtown in one of the world's largest metropolitan cities.
No.
It was a free money free-for-all that authorities are calling a mad dash for cash with benefits out of work millennials.
No.
There was a shooting spree gone wrong, but luckily no one got hurt. When a crowd heard the automatic fire coming from a role player in an unannounced drill taking place in downtown today.
No.
This was the reaction. Mass panic. Authorities say there never was any danger.
You're actually not watching CNN.
Breaking news.
Actually, this was the scene when Pokemon Go dropped a Snorlax in downtown Taiwan. What you're seeing now is thousands of people being controlled like human beings.
Let go! Snorlax!
By the CIA link development team of this blockbuster smartphone app.
1482!
Amassing the raw energy of location data from a horde of zombie drones rushing to receive their intangible electronic prize in the way of a virtual pretend dinosaur-like creature. It's a stunning sight that may prove to be one of the most historic studies of manipulated swarm behavior in humans ever documented on video. Sadly, the hive mind future is probably inevitable.
We are the Borg. Lower your shields and surrender your ships. Resistance is futile.
Just imagine how this is being weaponized.
So what was actually the truth? This. I don't know if you really read this while the video was shown. It says, this is some overreaching bullshit right here. Yeah, and people are volunteering for it. I don't know if you know George Orwell. I assume you do. So what we see here is that through, I don't know, an application, people are moved around, okay? And as he said in the video at the end, just imagine how this could be weaponized. So start to think, what are you actually doing? No? And but the video had also another part which I found really interesting. The first part, it showed the same picture and it always created a different story. And this is exactly our reality. This is post-truth. So stories are created. And this all together leads to a situation where population is easily controlled. Okay, so we have mass civilians, we have fear based, which leads to censorship. And we have a post-truth where we don't know what we can believe, what we can trust. And so this is a little bit the general ideas. And I don't know if you know Aaron Swartz. He was one of the most brilliant activists I've ever seen. And he said, without the ability to talk about government power, there's no way for citizens to make sure this power isn't being misused. Okay. So that's actually the current state of our world. And that's also the general idea behind these two movements. So I will start first with the crypto-anarchism movement. But it is important to realize that both movements started at the same time. So it's not that one was before the other. And what is crypto-anarchism actually about? So this image represents quite clearly what it is about. Because then in crypto-anarchism, we have on the one hand, we have cryptography, because it's all about privacy. It's about protection of our communication. Yeah? And on the other hand, it has this political anger. Because if you think about what actually anarchism means, it means no hierarchy. It means that we don't accept leadership. We have a flat communication and a flat organization. So on the one hand, we have the word crypto, which is represented as something private, something secret. And a form, this is a form of anarchism that operates in the secret using cryptography tools, okay, cryptographic tools, to protect the privacy, to protect the free speech. And on the other hand, anarchy, quite a lot of people always have in their head no state. Yeah, somehow, but it's actually far more general. It's actually about not having a leader. And if you know about Ethereum and DAOs, it's all about this. Yeah, it's about actually the condition of a society, entity, or group of people, or a single person that rejects hierarchy. Okay, that's the actual meaning of anarchism. And to manifest or to show what is the idea behind, they wrote a Crypto-Anarchist Manifesto in the 90s. So this was 92. And I will read now. This is one part only. I recommend you to read the whole manifesto. It's really interesting. And what is the most interesting part of it is that it was written in 92. Because if you read it, it seems like it's now. Yeah? So I will read just one part, and this part says, the technology for this revolution, and again, it's 92, it's not now, and it surely will be both a social and economic revolution, has existed in theory for the past decade. The methods are based upon public key encryption, zero-knowledge interactive proof systems, and various software protocols for interaction, authentication, and verification. But only recently, 92, but only recently have computer networks and personal computers attained sufficient speed to make these ideas practically reasonable, realizable. And the next 10 years will bring enough additional speed to make these ideas economically feasible and essentially unstoppable. Okay, so this was the idea back then, that with the internet, this will spread and we will create a whole new world. It will be connected, decentralized, encrypted, we have free speech everywhere. I don't know if we look at the world right now, where we are. So this is what I meant before. We are now with Bitcoin, with blockchain, we are again at the same point. Where do we want to go with this technology? And to let you know, there is actually an Institute of Crypto Anarchy in Prague, and they do conferences every year. And these conferences are also online, you can watch the videos, and it's really interesting. So they reflect a lot on our society, and it's all about spreading the idea behind this movement. So, as I said, the internet at this time was actually the technology of revolution. So crypto-anarchism was based on the movement of behind the World Wide Web. And what we've seen is when capital flew in this movement, corporates became to centralize the internet and became actually to change the whole idea. It wasn't anymore about collaborating and sharing. Suddenly we had closed software. Suddenly everything was closing down. This led to another development, which is the dark net. And this is a part of the internet which is not controlled, which is not, which can't be controlled also. And the idea behind it was actually to give again a room for free speech. But the problem, well, it's actually kind of funny because here we call it darknet. In some countries, it's the white net. Because in these countries, the only possibilities to actually speak is through this anger. Yeah? This is really important. And we live here in a kind of free world. But in a lot of parts of the world, it's not like this. And even here, we should ask ourselves how free we really are. And the problem always is if we enter this space, so we enter this space through anonymity. The way how we can protect our communication was we became totally anonymous. And this total anonymity has also a dark side. Because suddenly you don't need to be responsible anymore if you do something bad. And what came out of this situation is also an endorsement of the counter-economy. Counter-economy is an economy which is illegal by state law in certain places of the world, but actually is not doing any harm. So let's say Silk Road was kind of a counter-economy. Okay, but the problem is also, if we look at our world today, actually what is right depends on where you live. So this is a map which shows in which countries prostitution is legal and in which countries it's illegal. And if we look at the map, we see, even though it's still in the most of the countries where it is illegal, it's illegal, actually it varies a lot. So if you live in Madrid now, but you will move to Germany tomorrow, your idea should change. Suddenly you should think, oh, prostitution is actually a good thing, or at least I leave it legal. So we see that also with the internet and with the global mobilization, we have more and more the problem of defining what is actually right. And this, maybe you heard also about the situation of the dying nation state because of the traveling. Yeah? And so counter-economy might work if we all live in one place for always. But as we are moving, actually we can't define anymore what is right or not, because the states are defining it based on the location where you are. But in the end, and this is a little bit my own reflection on this research I've done, in the end we really have to decide between these two options, because on the one hand, if we want freedom of speech, nowadays we need to go dark, because we can't, in the controlled internet, we can't have free speech. We have to be aware of the consequences. But on the other hand, if we are totally anonymous, we know what is going to happen. Dark behavior might be facilitated. A way to go out of this, and actually it's already written in the manifesto of the crypto-anarchism, is reputation systems. Because what you can have and what you need is, if you have a community which is actually checking on behavior, without checking on the real identity, you might be able to detect behavior. Because this is also a really interesting problem we face right now with decentralization. Suddenly we need to decide what is right or what is wrong. Okay. First, when we lived in a world where the companies were deciding, we might be totally against Facebook now, but Facebook decided what is correct and what is not. And it also deleted all the bad stuff for us. If we have now a decentralized Facebook, who will delete the bad part? Who is checking that there's no child porn?
So a question on the reputation system. Yeah. Wouldn't it be also possible to sort of trick it or fool it? What are your thoughts on that?
What do you mean with trick it?
Well, the fact that, so you would have a reputation system which would counter dark behavior.
Uh-huh.
But if you have a group of people who sort of, who agree on positively rating each other, how would you counter that? It's just...
Well, at the moment, there is quite a lot of development on reputation system, and it's actually a really complicated topic, because... what we see also so far is that people are not using it the way we want them to use. But this could be a new research. This could be because we have this problem, this dilemma, freedom of speech and facilitating dark behavior. We want the first and not the second. We have this motivation to find these reputation systems. Actually, now, as we are not more, let's say, business-oriented in so many applications, they also need reputation systems to work, not only because of the ideological problem, but also because of their general application problem. So, but this is just an idea, and I think there will come up more ideas, and we actually have to switch our mind to, we can solve these problems, but we need to invent new ways which are based on community, which are based on decentralization.
Because it's a really a thought process, I don't have any. It's just that based on this, since it also stems a bit from anarchy, the idea that so it would be decentralized, what would you do, for example, say of all those years of learning, having state laws, which have evolved through time, how do you capitalize on all this knowledge, which has been human knowledge, and implement that in anarchy without starting from sort of starting over again?
Well, I think the idea is actually, it's connected to the free software movement and to actually, because if you, even though it was a really nice discussion in the when Linux came out, it was a discussion because some people feel, and I think this is actually in general, this is a topic, there's no right and wrong. And actually anarchism is about this. Anarchism is about discussion. Anarchism is not about, I'm presenting to you how we should do it. That's not the way. But in the free software movement, there was exactly this discussion that some programmers said, we need to free the code so that other people can build on top. And some coders said, no, because if someone changed my code, this is an insult to my code. Okay, so you see, this is the, you can understand both views, and we need far more discussion. In general, we need a lot about discussion. When do we need decentralization and when not? We don't have this discussion at the moment, I feel. But it's a good point. Okay, so then on the other hand, we have the cypherpunks. And the cypherpunks, they can be represented a little bit by this image. Because what is in what is necessary, let's say, even though that sounds a little bit weird, but to be a cypherpunk is that you write code, okay? A crypto-anarchist, you can be without writing code. But if you really want to be a cypherpunk, you have to write code. And a cypher is actually an algorithm which is used for encryption, okay? So this is where the name comes from. And cypherpunks, write code. And these two guys, or men, Eric Irish and John Gilmore, are the ones that started the movement, but they started the movement at the same time as Timothy May, which wrote the Crypto-Anarchism Manifesto. And they also wrote a manifesto, as you can see, nearly at the same time, which is the Cypherpunk Manifesto. And this is, it's a really, well, it's a long, it's a big page, full of text, but this text is really interesting. I really recommend you to read it. It has so much to do with our current situation and this so many years before. And in the center of this movement, there's also privacy, again, because privacy means protecting an open society. And something which I found really important, because I hear a lot of people saying, I have nothing to hide. Get all my data. Privacy is not about hiding. Privacy is, I don't want to show something to everyone, okay? It's like, why are you not going naked in the street, okay? Why do you put clothes? Because you don't want to that everyone sees you. That's a little bit the same situation. It's not about having a secret to hide, yeah? It's just, I don't want that everyone is seeing my data because there's no necessity for this. And therefore, obviously, they use cryptography. Yeah. But then, and this is where it comes to Bitcoin, obviously, if we have this open society, we also need an anonymous transaction system. And before Bitcoin, this was only cash. Okay, so they did everything through cash. Because obviously, if we use a digital system, which is not decentralized, which didn't exist before Bitcoin, there were intents, but none really achieved it. It will always go through entities. And so with Bitcoin, which was actually also, they have a mailing list. So they started, all the movement started with a mailing list. And Bitcoin was introduced to these people through the mailing list. And Eric was actually the first one, and he started, he started really early already discovering Bitcoin. He actually did the first transaction on Bitcoin. And he developed proof of work before Bitcoin even. Okay, so they were working, these people, these cypherpunks people, together with the crypto anarchists, were the people that were actually developing Bitcoin and the whole ideas behind it. And so this is a little bit the movement behind, but what is now the current state? Because I think this is also interesting for us now. So on the one hand, I don't know if you know all these people, so we have Julian Assange, who is the founder of WikiLeaks. I assume you know. You know this organization, which has the same goals. Yeah, it's also about giving us the right to access information. And Edward Snowden, a representative for the anti-civilian movement, and then we have the Linux creator, who was in particular for open source. And it's really really interesting to me. People laughed at him when he were writing his code. Now everyone is using the Linux operating system. And what we see right now is that these movements are connecting. Okay, so we don't have anymore all of them separate. We have these movements are connecting because actually the goals behind it are the same. They all fight for the same rights, but in a different way. And funnily, I mean, it's your decision how you will think about it, but two of these people are actually not free. Okay, so two of these people, they can't move as they want. And that's also representing our society. And then we have Amir Taki. I don't know if you know him. He is actually one of the core developers from Bitcoin. He started with Bitcoin because he was somehow into gaming. And he was really annoyed that he always had to pay through an intermediary. So he got into Bitcoin. But then he became also really fascinated by the actual idea. And he said something which I think represents exactly where we are right now. And this is where the internet was before, and this is where the hacker movement about personal computers were also before. So now the situation is Bitcoin is now in this crucial balance where it can either find itself like the other technology movements that have come before it, confined to irrelevance, or people can start to gather together to try to really truly think about on a social level what Bitcoin is really about. Okay, that's what I meant before. We are now in this moment. What do we actually want to do with this possibility? And I want to show you another video from a movement he created together with some other people you will recognize if you are in the blockchain space.
Maybe you thought you'd act differently. Maybe you thought you'd see it coming. But the moment's here. And it's time to make a choice. At its end of empire. The United States imagines the power to regulate the world's first great digital currency, Bitcoin.
It's a cyber currency, so how do we get to it?
To provide a framework for its existence. Technology that questions all previous frameworks, fitted for its straitjacket. Helping the United States is a group of lobbyists and corporations calling themselves the Foundation. Their mission is a performance, to both agree with and maintain an independence from regulatory power. But you can't have it both ways. OnSystem is an international group of activist developers led by Amir Taki. Concerned by the Foundation's centralized development and advocacy, they're developing a crypto wallet that runs on a completely independent software stack. This wallet runs on the back-end Libitcoin, the command tools SX, and the Obelisk blockchain server architecture. A thin wallet, the premier version of which will include privacy and security features, trustless mixing, and the foundation of a distributed identity protocol. Help us cover the next 4 months of full-time development. Help us make this implementation a line in the sand.
This is a technology. Now we are all being intercepted permanently. This is a state change.
My personal bank accounts were shut down. I'm blacklisted from having a personal bank account. It doesn't matter, I was able to use Bitcoin. And now we're hearing stories of people's personal accounts being blocked.
Why are you so dangerous?
They're saying they were comfortable operating in that environment because they felt that they enjoyed complete anonymity.
Are you watching? Are you listening? Bitcoin is what they fear it is. A way to leave.
We don't know you.
To forbid.
Don't want-
choice. There's a system approaching perfection. Just in time for our disappearance. So, let there be dark.
Okay. So this was a project called the Dark Wallet, which was started in 2015 by several hackers. You might have recognized some of them. And now, so what happened afterwards, Amir was one of the main visioners, and he left because he went, but he didn't left the idea, he didn't left the project, but he actually went to Syria to fight, actually, in the war. And now he's back, and he created now in Barcelona, actually, a whole new group of activists and hackers. And it's called, I think it's called the Institute of Autonomous Polytechnics. And this is like the actual state of the crypto-anarchist, if you want so. So what he's now trying is, he's there with really young people like you, and they create an institute because they learn. I haven't read the whole paper, but because I just discovered it. But I think it's quite interesting. And they try to create a whole new society. They actually try to create something what was the general idea in a region in Syria, which is called Rojava, I think. And they use Bitcoin there to give these people a possibility to become independent. And they teach them Bitcoin, they teach them cryptography, and they teach them new ways of creating a community. And it's all written down in this paper. And then on the other hand, we have that this is more the Bitcoin-related movement. In 2015, there came a new let's say, evolution of Bitcoin, which is Ethereum. And the idea was to create a whole world computer. Because the idea was, again, to decentralize power in the internet and to actually encrypt the information so that we can use it as it was supposed to be in a free way. And Gavin Wood, he is one of the founders of Ethereum, he said in one of the really early talks, so it's the Web3, the new internet, empowers the individuals, the operators. With that, there is some responsibility, but it is important to know that the possibility exists of that empowerment. We can only provide the opportunity. It's up to the people to use it and to help themselves. And in these words, there's so much of exactly the situation right now. So with this Ethereum, Bitcoin, we have the possibility to empower the people, to give them the possibility to create their own ideas of how they want to live, which community they want to create, which products they want to create, etc. But, and he's mentioning it, it's a lot of responsibility. To be autonomous is really hard work. And if you go back to the 60s, some scientologists said already that people, and we see this in our society now, we are really lazy, so we prefer the comfort instead of being free. Yeah? So to be free means also to be responsible and take this possibility, take this empowerment and do something with it. And as he says, we can only provide the opportunity. So Ethereum in these days were just an idea. It wasn't really ready. And it was just an opportunity to create something new. Now it's to us what we do with this. And now, if we look what's happening right now in the Ethereum community, we have Vitalik saying, if all that we accomplish is Lambo memes and immature puns about charting, then I will leave. Though, I still have a lot of hope that the community can steer in the right direction. So, I don't know if you know about this, but this was last year, where he actually asks, so what is it what we do with Ethereum? We just create, or what is it what we do with Bitcoin? We just create speculation. We just create ICOs that gain a lot of money. This is everything we do with this amazing technologies we have here. And so the resume is that quite a lot of people, and on this slide, there are obviously not all of these people. There are just a really few people. But they and so many more people, they dedicated their lives to make a change in this world. And they want to change the world to become free, because they actually fight for freedom. Yeah? But freedom means also responsibility. This is a really important connection. Because if we create a decentralized world, we also have to think about what will this create. If we create currencies which are totally anonymous, what society will come out of this? So we really also need to take responsibility about with this freedom. And to finish, I want to say something. So I'm German, as you might have heard from my accent. And I don't know if this is the reason why I'm reflecting quite a lot on our world and what's going on. And so Hitler and the Nazi regime, they weren't actually not so successful because they got supported or it was a shared idea in the population. But they had such a high success because there was no resilience. So people didn't take action. People were just extremely passive. And as Jacob Applebaum, he's an independent journalist, he's an activist, he's a hacker, he is a face of WikiLeaks and a core developer in Tor. And he said it, I think, in really good, or he expressed my own fear also in really good words. He said, when the next Holocaust comes, it will be our fault not having stopped it. Okay, that's it.